not producing anything but repression. So it was a revolt against that. What it turns out to be for, as the governor says, it's far too soon to tell.
Governor, do you want to chime in?
First of all, I'm glad there's a shakeup in the Middle East, although I think that our policy would prefer stability in the Middle East. But there was no long-term stability, is no long-term stability based upon these kinds of regimes that are out there right now, and I'm glad to see that. But I think that there is danger in American arrogance, a sense that somehow we can shape everything, that we are going to go out here and guide the way things are going to be without a reaction. I believe that we should create an environment where the right kinds of people can succeed. But if the perception in the Arab street is that these folks out there are our people that are going to do our bidding, they will fail. And so I think we should be cautious about that.
Ambassador?
I think the governor has good cautionary suggestion. There's no question that for the long term, our economy, getting our own economic house in order, is extremely important for sustaining our power. And that's vital. I think everyone agrees with that. With regard to what to do with this unfolding set of developments in the Middle East, not getting the role right and playing that role is also a decision that we would have to then live with the consequences of it, because others will not exercise the kind of restraint that could be prudent if one could assume that we could build a wall around each country in the Middle East and let it play itself out. And playing itself out, I think everyone is in agreement, we don't know where it's going to end in the long term, because these judgments that people are asking us to make today would have to be retrospective judgment after the change has played itself out. But there are some things on which we could make quick judgments, so we can't then use that very prudent statement about the long term. With regard to the near-term issues that have to be decided on and dealt with, there's no question that a change in Syria, given where things are geopolitically in the region, would be very positive. So, and I think on that, we cannot say, let's wait and see what happens over the next 20 years. I think we need to make some decisions now, and I believe that the administration has made a mistake to initially emphasize engagement with the regime, and then it has dealt with it in a less than adequate manner to mobilize and support, using our limited influence that we have, but it's not inconsiderable to mobilize support for that change. And that would have, as I said, very near-term effect in terms of the enemy that exists, Iran, which everyone is concerned about, and this change in Syria would be very beneficial, in my judgment, in the short term, in terms of this bigger problem that we see with regard to Iran.
We have to be prepared for a worst case scenario here, which is an emerging, much larger, more slowly unfolding, essentially Iranian Revolution 2.0, as you see the ascendance of these Islamist parties across the region. And so far they've been behaving more shrewdly than maybe many people feared that they would. They have not immediately abrogated the Camp David Accords example, but shrewdness is not a substitute for virtue. And we have to have our eyes wide open. I mean, we're talking about, and I hate to go back to culture again, but because these are mass movements, we have to talk about culture. We're talking about countries that can fill stadiums with people chanting one nation, another Holocaust, which happened in April 2011 in Egypt. This is a reality we have to face. And here's the other reality, and this is something I experienced in Iraq. Even though we had 150,000 soldiers on the ground when I was there, plus countless contractors, plus a large diplomatic corps, USAID, our influence on Iraqi culture and Iraqi mindset and ideas was minimal. I was in areas where there had been American soldiers for 6-7 years, constant engagement. And you weren't going to break tribal bonds. You weren't going to even begin to understand some of the complex relationships in store. So the Middle Eastern culture is going to have to be reformed by Muslims. We can't do it, but we have to be prepared for the negative consequences in case their reform is negative.
That brings me to this. In 2009, the people of Iran, who've been ruled longest by Islamists, They rose up after a blatantly fraudulent election, and the Obama administration decided not even rhetorically to reach out to them. They wanted, the Obama administration wanted to deal with leaders, not with people. When the people went out on the street and said, Obama, are you with us or against us? He did not respond. But we have interceded in Libya. We did facilitate the departure of Mubarak in Egypt. We're not doing very much, I would say, in Syria at this moment. Two questions arise. Do we have a coherent, does this administration have a coherent policy towards the Middle East at this point? And if not, what would be the main pillars of such a policy? And maybe I'll go to, I'll start with you, Elliott.
I think they have a coherent policy. The policy is to re-elect President Obama. Yeah. That's their policy in the Middle East, that's their policy in Asia, that's their policy in Virginia, that's their policy everywhere. That sums it up. Beyond that, I see no coherence.
The second part is, yes, what are the pillars of our policy?
I don't see it. People in the Middle East have said to us, you people are hypocrites about Bahrain, because you've got a revolt in Bahrain where not really supporting it. In Libya, you did support it. In Syria, you're half supporting it. And I think that criticism is valid. It's very hard to see a common thread in the policy of this administration, going back really 3 years from the beginning of its policy in the Middle East. It's not to say these are not very complex problems, but their policy toward Iran, their policy toward Israel, their policy in the Middle East in general, has been really failing for 3 years.
Anybody else want to weigh in on, Ambassador, if you're advising President and Secretary of State right now on this, what would you say our policy should be as opposed to what it is?
First, they're not likely to take my advice.
I don't think so.
Second of all, I think that Elliott is right, that currently domestic re-election drives much of what the administration is doing. But when they came to power, I think being different than Bush was the other main priority. They didn't believe in the ideology of promoting freedom. They thought stability was vital, and therefore in order to ensure stability, you had to appease or engage or work with adversaries to make them less adversarial. And this issue at the same time cut back the level of effort vis-a-vis the region. You know, your adversaries never try to help you when you indicate to them that you're in some difficulty. They take advantage of you. And I think that that's what has happened in Iran. That's compared to 3 years ago, the Iranian nuclear program is much more advanced than it was. So this strategy clearly of shaping behavior through engagement while indicating retreat from the region has not produced the result that it wanted. I think that I would prioritize now. We know that we have a lot of preoccupations around the world, so you need to prioritize. And I put once again the emphasis on Syria's role at this time. The other struggle, and I think what has been said about the role of political Islam and how it might mature in different directions is extremely important, and we need to be cautious about that enthusiasm for the change. So we have to hedge against the various potential scenarios. I agree with all of that. But that's going to take time to work it out. Syria is here and now. And therefore, in my view, the administration and those of us interested in national security should need to encourage it, pressure it, incentivize it to do more. But I think the perception there is that the people don't care. People don't want too much engagement. So therefore, they have made virtue of this by focusing the policy in terms of domestic resonance, and the domestic resonance do less. That's what they believe.
Well, I think that if we make it clear that there are bodies of people engaged in the Arab Spring who, if they are successful, they will find a warm, friendly hand from the United States, and a partner with the United States is an appropriate thing to do. I think we should be cautious about appearing to try to dictate the result. Because if we try to dictate the result, I can assure you we'll get the opposite. So I think what I'm suggesting, based upon the foreign policy that I've observed in the last number of years, is that a more deft hand is called for. A more sophisticated approach that does not send the message into the Middle East that we're trying to dominate the Middle East, but that we seek partners and friends in the Middle East, and that we would encourage them so that we don't see either monarchists or dictators or Islamic anti-Israel, anti-United States type of people, but people who actually have some forward-looking ideas for the future in the Middle East. They're the people that we want to encourage.
I'm going to let Elliott Abrams go because he's going to be on TV. Thank you very much for your contribution. We're going to stay with you for a few more minutes. The next issue I want to raise, and I really want to raise it in this forum because it is raised so infrequently, if at all, on television or in the major media, and that is right now, as you probably at least know, the Christians of Egypt are under tremendous pressure. It's worse now than it has been in a very, very long time. But that's not all that's going on. Right now in Iran, you have an Iranian who has been sentenced to death, and his crime was that he converted to Christianity. We had not long ago a woman, a Christian woman, in Pakistan who said something that insulted Islam, or so it was said. She was sentenced to death. The governor of Punjab province, a Muslim, said it's ridiculous that we would sentence people to death for saying something offensive. He was shot to death by his own bodyguards. And people were warned not to pray at his funeral. What we have going on here, I would put to you, or I'm going to ask you if you agree with me, is a war that is taking place within what we call the Islamic world right now against Christians, and by the way, against other minorities, against the Baha'i, against the Kurds in many cases, obviously against the only Jewish state. Oh, there is ethnic and religious cleansing going on throughout the Muslim Middle East, and remarkably to me, for most of the media, this is not even a story, this is not even worth discussing. David, you want to talk about this?
At American Center for Law and Justice, we're directly involved in Pastor Nader Khani's defense in Iran and have been working for him to keep him alive for a very long time. And what we are seeing as we undertake this effort, and also we're working on behalf of Coptic Christians in Egypt and Christians in Iraq, is there is, number one, in the larger Muslim world, there is zero tolerance as a rule of other faiths. It goes back to what I said. We're talking about democracy without respect for individual liberty. That's just another form of tyranny. The other thing that we're seeing is it's incredibly difficult to even get domestic American politicians to dial into this issue, even though many of their constituents are very interested in it. Many of their constituents are very, very concerned. I think it is seen often as a distraction from sort of larger geopolitical issues, and what ends up happening is we ignore the fundamental injustice of what's happening in the Middle East, because that injustice is seen as somewhat of an inconvenience in the greater geopolitical game. And we can't view it as just an inconvenience. The plight of the Christians in the Middle East has to be a priority in our American community, because by helping them, we are going to teach about individual liberty. And there has to be instruction in the Middle East about individual liberty.
Well, I agree with what has been said, but also we have to recognize and hear the advice from the governor on being prudent and cautious as to know, not to give the impression as if we could control developments there, is to recognize that what's happening is really a crisis of civilization in the Islamic world, particularly in the Middle East, where there are various forces with different visions of what should the region look like are in conflict with each other. And there have been periods where more secularist, tolerant forces have been dominant in one place, and now you're getting this rise of Shia fundamentalism in Iran and the rise of Sunni kind of Islamic fundamentalism in some of the Arab world. And this is going to take a long time to work itself out, everyone, including the Muslims, but certainly the Christians and the minorities will be affected by it. And that's why I think, given what has been said, that although we should have be prudent in terms of our expectations, but we can't be indifferent to it either, because it affects a huge part of the world where we have vital interests, including interest in the rights of minorities, whether they're ethnic or religious, including and the Christian community.
Cliff, I do think that it's important to tell people in the Middle Eastern world and the Arab world what we Americans believe in. I think it is important to declare strongly what we believe in, and not to have our mission and our ideas and our goals distorted or confused or have people misled as to what we're attempting to do. When I studied foreign policy back at the university many years ago, we all learned that the age of colonialism is over. We're not going to be colonialists. Nobody wants us to be colonialists. If that becomes our policy in order to try to influence policy, we will lose and we will fail. And they know it and we know it. But at the same time, I just finished reading The Looming Tower. Many of y'all probably have read that book. And I am horrified by the foreign ideologies that go through the Middle East that are so intolerant of not only their own citizens, but of the American values as well. It seems to me that we have to make it clear that we extend the hand of partnership and friendship, but that we are of a people. And that if they want to be friends with us, they have to recognize that we have values too in this world that we need to assert. And we will not be friends with people that misuse their women, that destroy their people, that abuse their children, that believe in suicide bombings. We must condemn these things. But we also have to make it clear that, like with Egypt, we are the largest trading partners with Egypt. Number one, both imports and exports. If we can project that people of goodwill in the Arab and Middle Eastern communities care something about their futures, and frankly, I believe they do. I believe suicide bombers are an anomaly within the Middle East. If you believe that they believe in a future, we can, I think, make the case that if they are simply willing to work with us on common human values, then there's a future partnership between us.
We're running out of time, but I want to give everybody a chance to finish up.
Well, I think that condemnation is very important. We have to be clear what we stand for and what we are against. That's very important. But that's not enough. Let's be clear. There's a real fight going on for the future of this region. Statements are not enough, powerful as they might be. And you have to make, at least at the minimum, aim for a level playing field between different forces that are at work and the forces that share our values, stand with us, in consultation with them as to what American support would be prudent, not an imposition by us, but what it is that they think they need in order to be able to be competitive, to remove some of the limitations that we have put on ourselves, such as not helping, being able to help political parties that stand for kind of humane values. You have to have a finding by the president, you have to have several committees get to know to help people that we think need help. So I think that, yes, clarity on principles is excellent, but action is also required, the strategy is required, plans are required, being prudent is also very important. So I completely agree with that, but I think we need to do more than just make our positions clear.
David, a final thought?
Very, very quickly. Number one, we can't be naive. We have to be realistic as we look at the Middle Eastern culture. We just can't be naive. Number two, if these movements claim to represent freedom from tyranny, we have to send a clear message we're not going to subsidize the persecution and annihilation of Christian communities. And number three, if any of you guys have, and I would strongly recommend this book by Bing West on the success of the surge in Iraq called The Strongest Tribe, we have to continue to be the strongest tribe and be prepared for any negative ramifications from the Arab Spring. We have to be prepared.
Last word from the governor.
Last word. I would ask everybody here to go to our Free Congress webpage, freecongress.org, and look at the growth code. At the end of the day, we can't do any of this if we become a weak power. And that means that we have to have our economic power. In the meanwhile, while we're dealing with this, I simply ask that we be as sophisticated as we can be with this, because this is a big challenge and the game has not yet played out. And it's going to require, I think, calmness and sophistication and strong leadership. Thank you.
I think, thank you very much, Governor. I think what we've heard today is some debate, but there's a great deal of consensus as well. The governor is saying, I think rightly, we cannot export democracy, but we also can't abandon Democrats abroad, those who share our values. I think what the ambassador is saying is that we have to be a strong country. We have to protect our freedoms. Our freedoms will be endangered if we do not, and we have some very, very dangerous enemies out there, and they know what they want to do. When death to America is written on every bomb in Iran, that is not simply a joke. Defenddemocracy.org is my organization, a lot more on all of these subjects there. Thanks to the panel, and thanks to you.